So, Yanik, thanks a lot for doing this today. So when Yanik agreed to do this, I was really excited, obviously, because those of you who have heard about him before know this is a unique opportunity to be able to land you for this. I really appreciate it. And we talked last week, got a whole bunch of notes, and then Yanik came back and said, hey, Ingar, here, I've got a bunch of other things to look at, too. And I've had about 100-some-odd pages of stuff to read before we came talk today. So why don't we just go ahead and get started like we talked about on the phone, which is how this all started for you. So let's go back in your history and talk a little bit.
Yeah, I'll give you a quick little history, and then you know what I'd love to do with you guys, I mean, this is a pretty interesting, diverse group, is keep it more of a conversation than me talking to you guys. So I started, just real quick history, my family came over from Russia when I was 2.5, and like any good immigrant success story, my dad came over with $256 in his pocket, not real command of the English language, and then he started his own company and ended up doing pretty well, growing it to a couple $1 million, and as a family business, I did pretty much anything and everything in there, and I telemarketed when I was 14, the deal with my dad was, I was 16, so the deal was I got a car if I went cold called on doctors. So he's like, go, Mr. Yanik, go make some sales. And I'm like, all right. So I'm talking to like 50-year-old docs when I'm 16, and I got a really big head start in marketing and sales, but I realized that cold calling sucked. I mean, it really sucked. So one of my doctor clients gave me this Jay Abraham tape, and it kind of opened the doors to direct response marketing, which is all about how to write letters, ads, whatever, and get people to actually raise their hands and give you money without actually talking to them, and that was a lot better. And so I really became a master of that and started my own publishing company doing just that when I was, I guess, 25. Left my dad's business and I was like 26, which is a super hard decision to leave a family company like that. So I thought I was going to take it over, grow it, really build it, and I realized that that wasn't the right path for me. And so this was like 99, and that's when the internet started really kind of coming together, and I'm like, wow, you know, there's lots of people out there that are making money online. I'm like, I wonder what they're doing. And so I started studying that, and that was when I first created my very first product online. That was my first $1 million product called Instant Sales Letters. And that was literally at 3 o'clock in the morning, wake up and have this idea for fill-in-the-blank sales letter templates. And then from that, people are like, well, how did you do that? And maybe you could help teach me how to do that. And that was kind of sort of the career path, except for the last 5 years.
Well, just keep going. So how did that migrate? Just keep going your story here.
From there, it turned into a lot of different, basically, so I have a couple different skill sets. I mean, I've been involved in selling content in every way, shape, and form since 2000. So if you have any content you want to get out there, I mean, I've sold everything from couple dollar ebooks to multi-$100 home study courses to live events to $40,000 more advanced coaching, peer-to-peer groups, so pretty much anything and everything related to content. And that was over those courses of years. And then like 5 years ago, I kind of looked at my life and had a great family, had a great reputation, but I wasn't totally happy. And I don't know how many of you can kind of relate to that. And I'm like, well, that's kind of weird because I'm making a ton of money, and you look at the outside, all the things that I really wanted, and it wasn't quite what really made me happy. And I'm like, I can't do this for another 5 years or 10 more years. And I made a list of all the things I really wanted in an ideal business. It was like unique experiences, adventures, hanging out with cool entrepreneurs, brainstorming, having impact, some sort of philanthropic part of it, all these other characteristics. And that sort of created this start for these this Maverick group of companies. And that turned into this really high level peer group. Basically, I created, like, I scratched my own itch. I created a group that I really wanted to have, and that's what Maverick 1000 turned into, which is a peer group of really high-level, exceptional entrepreneurs who are doing remarkable things, and we go off and do some cool adventures together. We'll have some unique retreats, but there's also an impact element, so we're looking to change the world in some way together and have some fun in the process.
Talk a little bit about the emotional pull for that. When we talked about on the phone about this, you mentioned that this was, well, maybe I'm putting words in your mouth, but this was sort of a drive to being more holistic or helping business leaders become more holistic about how they live their lives.
I think, I don't think the diagram's on the 34 rules, but on the books, some of you have the books, on the back of the books, like, I'm a pretty simple person, so I like simple diagrams. So if you originally, I know a lot of entrepreneurs were like, okay, it's about the money, it's about the bottom line, it's about the cash and the profits, and that's certainly one measure. So if you look at, you create a circle, I just learned that this is called the Venn diagram. You make a circle and you put a dollar sign in there, and you make another overlapping circle and you put a happy face and you put another overlapping circle and you put a heart, which is for me for impact or giving. And that to me is like very simple, but it really encompasses all parts of our lives as entrepreneurs. I look at it as make more, have more fun, and give more. And you can really extract a lot of things from there. And each of those actually affect each of the other parts, which to me is the most fascinating and interesting. Like the, even if you look at it from a completely pragmatic ROI standpoint, the more you give, the more you typically get. And you see that in like networking events. I mean, that's what Cadre is all built on. It's not, hey, what do you do? And, you know, here's my business card and fling it around like a 2-for-1 Red Lobster coupon. And it's, so that part of it, like the giving part, and like, so I've met a lot of people through some of the charitable stuff that I've done that have been really instrumental in growing my business. And I've also found that the more fun I have in my business, the more fun I have in my life, the more our profits go up. And that's been really interesting to see those interconnect. And I think a lot more entrepreneurs want to stop and kind of, you know, there's so many excuses. Well, you know, once I reach the whatever plateau it is for you, then I can go off and go have some fun, or I can go do something just for me, or I can go, you know, donate to that charity that I've been meaning to donate to or whatever. And I think it can really just incorporate it into all our day-to-day activities if possible.
So keep going
on that.
I don't want to stop him from going down this path.
I mean that's like I said, that's the thing that's most fascinating to me, and that's where I concentrate right now the most is really thinking about that. And I look at 21st century business owners and entrepreneurs as this is kind of a really unique opportunity in a time in history where we can like the consumer criteria is changing. I think our employee criteria is changing. It's like if we, so I look, Tom's Shoes is a great example. So I'm friends with Blake from Tom's Shoes who started it. And you look at what they did. Does anyone know Tom's Shoes, by the way? So everyone knows it. All right, the buy one, give one. Okay, so they have these little shoes. The shoes are like, I don't know, like flat, kind of weirdish looking shoes that are okay. And like canvas boat shoes. But the cool thing about it is you buy a pair of shoes and they give a pair of shoes away to a child somewhere in need in a developing country. And so using that model, and it's a for-profit business, it's not just a social enterprise, it's designed to make profits. And they've been able to grow and get partnerships that they weren't able to grow, get, you know, just by saying, hey, we give away 5% to children's charities or something like that. So I look at them as a really interesting hallmark for that impact element. And if I think of ways that, you know, we can really incorporate that into what we're doing as a business that genuinely and authentically reflects what we're all about. So a lot of people have done that one-for-one model and done it successfully. Like Warby Parker is a very big eyeglass company now, or not very big, but they're getting bigger. And they've done that, you know, buy one, we're gonna give another pair away. The one laptop per child thing was doing pretty good with that. Had a client who literally had a 9-year-old kid that had a blanket that they wanted to get out there and sell, and they had this one blanket that they, and then they give it away to kids in children's hospitals. So if it fits in an authentic way, that one for one's a pretty interesting thing. We just started this on our educational side, selling content, is we give away 3-for-1 scholarships. Where if somebody buys, like we just had our big online marketing event a couple weeks ago, I guess, or a month ago, and we had about 450 people there, and so we gave away live streams, 3 of them for every paid ticket that we had there, and we gave away to different young entrepreneur groups, we gave them away to returning military vets, and we gave them away to people with disabilities. And so that's our commitment now with our educational initiatives, is everyone that buys anything that we sell as educational side, we're going to give away 3 scholarships to it. But there's actually a very pragmatic point of view too. So I got my team now focused on how many scholarships we can give away, because automatically that's going to drive sales. So our goal is to give away 100,000 scholarships by 2015, which means that we have to sell 33,333 of them which drives the bottom line. So I'm not about, hey, let's just give away all our profits. Let's actually use that as a driver for profits and in a way that can be really interesting and exciting. And so part of my big picture where I get really excited about those scholarships is then we create a trained pool of people that, you know, might learn the latest in 21st century job skills. And then we have a big pool of network of entrepreneurs that we talk to who could then hire them as virtual interns and use them to grow their business where they get real world experience, and then they can go off and go, you know, apply it on their own or do whatever. So I look at it as even bigger than let's just give away a bunch of scholarships. Mm-hmm. So that's to me is most interesting for that.
Well, let me change gears a little bit here, if that's all right.
Yeah.
And talk a little about a couple of the points that that came up in our conversation. One of them was the idea about leverage.
Yeah.
And well, why don't I just have you talk a little about leverage, if that's all right. I mean, I can give you context about it, but I think you mentioned that leverage is really just the big underlying principle of your approach. Why don't you, can you talk a little about that?
Yeah, so I love, that's probably one of the things that I do pretty well is I can go into just about anybody's company or what they're talking about and find some sort of hidden asset or something that's leverageable in some way that they might not have looked at. And so for me, leverage is definitely the way that I've grown our company because I still work out of the house. I started out of a one-bedroom apartment, which sounds like, you know, a little bit like an infomercial, which is fun. And then my wife got laid off about 6 months after we got married, and so then she went to work with me, not totally willingly, but so she was in the bedroom and I was in the living room working out of this one-bedroom apartment. But the only way that we were really able to grow this thing was through leverage, and the internet, you know, right now gives you the most leverage imaginable because, especially direct response, which you can literally have a website and you have 5 people that hit the website or have 1,000 people or 10,000 or a million people. And by what the words that we put on there or the images or the sales video or whatever it is, the compelling message, that's where the leverage is there. And you're able to, where it's really fascinating is you can literally change a couple words or one word and you'll see different results. And so you'll see there's leverage in that case. And where I also used leverage to grow our business was we had about 40,000, 50,000 affiliates that were working for us. Essentially, they were like a free sales force. And they would drive traffic to our sites. And if they made a sale, they got paid. If they didn't, they didn't get paid. So there's a lot of leverage there. And I'm also always looking at what are kind of like those little points. So when my kids came along, it was, for me, I love the 80-20 rule, the Pareto principle. You guys have all heard of that. Mm-hmm. And it's really important to start evaluating where those 20% activities are for you guys. And for some things, it's going to be 95-5. And that's really interesting. Like, so I mentioned that 40,000, 50,000 person affiliate network I had. If I really looked at it, it was like more like 95-5, maybe even 97-3, where 3% of our affiliates are driving the vast majority of our traffic and sales and promotion. So then it's like, okay, they deserve more attention, and we need to give them special attention, special things to help them. And then I also look at like just leverage and like hidden assets. A lot of it's in IP, because that's you know, been my whole world for the last 15 years. But a lot of us have hidden IP leverage that we don't even think about. So I'll take, I'll pick on Craig for a second. So Craig, what are you guys in the top, what, for your industry?
Top 100 mortgage companies in America.
Top what?
100? Top 100 mortgage companies in America.
Okay, so I imagine some other mortgage companies might want to know what the hell you guys do.
Sure.
So you probably have this amazing, you know, these hidden assets of IP and processes and things that you guys do that, unless you're going to go nationwide or unless you're, you know, think about what you're going to do with it in a bigger scope, it's just going to lay dormant. So what I've been able to help a lot of people with is to take what they're using in their companies or their businesses or in other places and be like, okay, great, we're going to package this up and sell it back to our industry and sell it in a big way. And then sometimes those other revenue streams actually become even bigger than their main company's business because of the margins and the leverage available for selling information. But then it gets interesting for leverage, like for you, like let's say, and I'm totally throwing this out of, you know, left field, but let's say you're like, well, great, you know, we do this particular loan and it's something we do that's really, really specific and we want to do more of it. We could do it nationwide, but we don't have the feet, you know, the people on the ground to do it. So then it's like, great, we're going to license, we're going to do an area exclusive license to different mortgage groups, one per area, and do it all across the country. And then they're going to be a feeder for us. And then let's say we get even more aggressive and interested. And so I'm talking to a buddy of mine a couple days ago, he's a Maverick member and he's in the real estate world. And he's like, I want to train people in what we're doing because I want to basically build up our own REIT. So, you know, if you got really aggressive, you're like, wow, I could build up our own REIT too. And then not only make the money on selling this, but then we could have an ongoing asset of the REIT. So that's, you know, I like to keep layering multiple things on there and seeing where that leverage is. And, you know, I don't know if that example even remotely makes sense, but we'll pull it out of thin air for that.
So, not to pick on Craig, I'm not picking on Craig. A very nice client of mine, so I'm not going to pick on Craig. But let's just take some notional Craig. So not Craig, but another home loan company out there. And what if they came back and said, and you probably hear this a lot. So it sounds to me that they're basically going to sell what in many cases is their competitive advantage, right? You're going to help them define their competitive advantage, really. And so what's the argument? What's the argument against that? So someone says, "Yeah, you know, I can't do this because I'm going to be giving away my advantage."
Like if you don't compete anywhere outside of the DC metropolitan area, then that's great. Right. Then I'd only sell it there, and then it also becomes a really good reason why. And you know, one of my favorite books is "Influence: The Psychology of Persuasion" by a guy named Robert Cialdini, and in there he talks about giving people reason why and because, and it's a, you know, major psychological trigger for people. And so the more we can incorporate reason why into our arguments and sales process, then it makes a lot of sense. It's like, hey, I'm not going outside of the DC metropolitan area. This is just, you know, this is what has been able to drive our company, but, you know, we're not competing anywhere else. So if you're in those areas, we're not selling to you. But if you're outside of it, we're going to sell to you. But, you know, there's 100 ways to kind of skin the cat on it, and it's all based on what you want to do with it.
So now we didn't talk about this beforehand. So if I'm throwing a curveball at you, just let me know. But do you have another, maybe a specific example of a company, and maybe you can keep the names, protect the innocent. But example of a company you helped discover new ways to leverage IP that they hadn't thought about before. I mean, I think it'd be really neat to hear some of those creative ideas.
I could talk about you. I was going to not talk about you, but yeah.
if it was from like a private.
Yeah,
like
let's talk about, so Derek's a great example. So Derek tripled his financial planning practice with a really unique process of generating referrals that were kind of like an unlimited referral base. And it was sort of the genesis for what Cadre has become, but he did it in a smaller setting with people that were really, I don't know, like an affinity group for his high level net worth clients. So it could be an interior designer, it could be an architect, it could be a person that does wardrobe, fashion consulting, it could be estate planning attorneys, it could be any other kind of professionals that these high net worth individuals would need. And so they would refer among each other their best clients, and that became a really great referral network, and that's how, you know, one of the main ways that you grew your financial practice. And so Derek and I were talking for a while, and I'm like, well, you know, we could really turn that into something that we could sell. And so we're packaging this up, and we're going to sell it. I don't know what the final price is going to end up being, maybe like $3,000 to $5,000.
We're going to sell whatever you tell me.
Yeah. We're going to sell it to other trust agents, so mortgage guys, financial planners, attorneys, and so forth. And so that's, you know, that's one way of doing it. But I've done it where we had, so actually here's another interesting example where two steps off, right? So the first step was this woman was really great at putting her kid to sleep. So any of you can remember when you had little kids, like our second kid, Zoe, who's a little firecracker, she was like super colicky and just a little pain in the ass and didn't go to bed. But if you have one of those, then yeah, it's worth a lot of money. And so So she, what she did was she was really good at it with her own kids, and then she sort of started selling like sleep coaching on the side, and that went really well. And we got together and she learned about how to leverage herself, and so we created a product, and the product was, I forgot, it might be maybe $99 or $49. It was pretty cheap, like teaching moms how to, or dads too, how to put their kids to sleep. And so they're doing pretty good with it. They're doing like $500,000 a year selling this thing. And then I'm like, okay, well, here's what the next level is you have all these people that have bought this product. They want to, you know, wouldn't that be an amazing certification program that you could offer? And she's like, yeah, that would be. And she's like, oh, you know, maybe we'll sell it for like $1,000. I'm like, no. You know, we start thinking about, okay, what's the value of it? And so like one of the 34 rules is that you're always striving to create 10x to 100x in value. And so I'm like, so one of my questions is, okay, well, what's it worth to this coach to be able to do it? What were you charging? And she was like $150 an hour to teach parents how to do that. I'm like, great, well, how many clients do they need? You know, they only need a few of them to do pretty good. So we started selling it for $7,000, and we sold out her certification program. And that certification program was even more than selling the, you know, the $500,000 worth of product. So that's one way of taking, you know, keep leveraging and leveraging what you're doing. And it's always about, okay, who's got more to gain than I do even.
So so I'm going to move a little bit for actually, look, so I'm going to extend that a little bit more about leverage. We talked a little bit about, I am going to get into some of the other business things we talked about, but we talked a little bit about big rocks, you know, okay. The idea. And so I think this is just the idea. One of the things that leverage, I'll just put words in your mouth again, one of the things that leverage gets you is it gets you more time. Right, clearly, you know, if you can spend all your time, and you said one of your Maverick rules there, don't ever sell time, right?
Yeah, if possible.
Right, and it seems
that's a hard one to get out of for a lot of people. And you know, I still do a little bit of consulting every now and then if I like the client and I'm interested in what they're doing. And so I'll do, it's like $10,000 a day, but and people are like, wow, that's a pretty good day. I'm like, yeah, maybe, but I've also spent an entire day. And, you know, they're also getting, you know, 15 years of experience there. Plus, you know, there's no real ongoing, right? There's nothing, you know, maybe I could ask for a percentage of sales on top of what brings them, but it's harder to do. So mm-hmm. There's not that much leverage there. And even for, you know, look at actors and celebrities, right? Even the best paid ones are trading their time for money. And sometimes that's enough if they're really well paid. But the smart ones, like, you know, like 50 Cent and his deal with Vitamin Water, like that was freaking brilliant. where he got 10% of the company, which turned into a stake that was worth like about $100 million, and they sold it to Coke for $4 billion. Like that's freaking smart. And that's, you know, that's the way you wanna think about stuff, where it's like, what's, you know, maybe we'll get a little bit less now, but maybe there's a payday somewhere else down the line. But for the, you wanna talk about big rocks?
Yeah, you know, because the point that I was getting from that conversation really was that you need to figure out what is the most valuable thing to you, right?
Yeah.
And is it earning a lot of money, or is it actually earning the time that you have that
yeah.
allows you to be creative and do incredible things like your adventures, the thing, for example. So,
yeah, the so when I was kind of reevaluating part of my life, I guess, was there's one of my buddies has a really good analogy, and it's partially based on, I think, you know, Stephen Covey's book, Seven Habits, has this in there, and I've heard a couple different stories of them, but you think about, you know, your glass there in front of you, if you got a couple big rocks that are the big key pieces of your life, you have to put those in first, and if it's all business related, then there's not gonna be much room else for pretty much anything else. And a lot of people are creating their lives around their business instead of trying to sculpt their life first and then seeing where the business fits. And I'm a big believer in that we get to make the rules. And it's, you know, unless you're trying to build a $1 billion company, yeah, you're probably gonna have to make a couple sacrifices and work probably more than you want to. But there's a lot of ways to get to where we want. And we don't have to follow the exact status quo. And I think that's actually probably the worst way of getting there. If we're following industry norms and the way someone else has done stuff, then we're only going to be as good as we can be within this small little window of rules that are set forth by somebody else. You know, you look at all the disruptive technologies that have come about, it's all because they didn't follow the same rules. I mean, look at, I mean, cable TV was originally a disruptive technology because they didn't follow the rules of the big, I guess, three or then four with Fox. And then YouTube came along and completely obliterated that idea that there should only be, you know, a couple shows and channels on there, because, and that was a massive disruption, and they sold for a whole lot of money to Google. So if we go back to, by the way, I have ADD, so you can throw me off.
Good, really keep going, keep going. Yeah, no.
So the rocks. So if we go back to thinking about the rocks, like that's right. Like, I don't know. That to me is like, we're at the end of the day, are you going to really wish that we did some more stuff at the office, or are we going to wish that we did something really cool with our lives and that mattered? Like, I don't know, my wife fights me on this sometimes. Like, we had a CAPS charity thing that I was a part of with Dreams for Kids, which some of you heard of, a local charity. They take disadvantaged youth and will let them do cool stuff with professional athletes. And so I took my son, who's 7, out of school. Not like, you know, first grade is that academically intense, but I mean, in Potomac, I guess it could be. But so I took him out, and Missy, my wife, was like, "No, you can't take him out." I'm like, "I'm taking him out," and so I took him out. He had a great day, and also it was a great day because he got to see, you know, he got to actually work with some of these kids. And I told him ahead of time, I'm like, "Hey, if there's no caps that show up, are you still gonna be happy?" He's like, "Yeah, I want to," you know. I told him about the kids. He's like, "I want to be with the kids." I'm like, "All right, well, that's a good, you know." I think that he's saying that for real. And but there was a couple cool caps that showed up, and he had a great day. And my wife's like, "Yeah, you know, you're right." So I'm a huge believer in just getting people out of that normal status quo. And it's like why do things the exact same as right, everybody else? Because you're gonna get the exact same results.
Yeah, it's worked very well for you, right?
It's worked okay.
And so a few years ago, someone let you talk a little bit about, I asked you again when we talked on the phone about your biggest failure really in business. And it wasn't really a failure, but it set you back or wasn't as productive as things had been for you before. And we can talk a little bit about that, just the lessons learned, what happened, lessons learned, and so forth.
So this is kind of interesting. So like I said, 5 years ago, I started this Maverick group of companies, and the original idea was called Maverick Business Adventures, where it's just going to be like, I didn't have friends to really go on cool adventures and experiences with, because they all either had
jobs,
a lot of money and not enough time, or too much time and not enough money to go do these things. So I'm like, great, well, I'll create this thing, and we'll go do cool adventures together, and it'll be some sort of charitable element, and it'll also be a business element to it. And it worked out okay, except for the fact that I ended up burning about $400,000 trying to get this thing straight. And it was like, when, you know, everyone's heard this idea of the passion. If you have passion, that the profits will follow. And sometimes the passion is, like, I'm a huge believer in passion, and because it's going to help you persevere through the hard times in your business. But if you got too much passion and it's kind of occluding this pragmatic business model part of it, so you got to figure out, is it a business or is it just a hobby? And it was a pretty expensive hobby. And then, you know, my wife's like, "Well, what the hell are you doing?" And I'm like, "I don't know." That's a good question. But we were able to do some really cool stuff. And so we had some tweaks to the business model. And that was enough to, you know, for some people, it's you know, a $10,000 hit on the head or a $50,000 hit on the head. For me at that point, it took $400,000 because I ended up hiring people I didn't need to hire, or doing stuff that, you know, I think that, and it's in one of the rules, and I didn't follow my own rules, and it's like, lack of money creates more creativity. So that's why I'm a huge believer in bootstrapping. So if I said, okay, I got $25,000 or $50,000 I'm gonna set aside for this thing, and I'm gonna see what happens, instead of like just unlimited checkbook that I kept writing into it, and it would've been a lot better. And so sometimes when we're starting off, we do even better because we have to be creative in that way. And so, but that set me back, but it was interesting because, and I know you have in there that painted picture that I showed you.
Yeah.
So my big aspirations for what I want to do with the
this
Maverick
one?
Group, yeah, the Maverick Group of Companies has changed and dramatically increased because of that setback where I'm like, wow, shit, things aren't working. That means that we have to change something. And then that turned it into a, you know, a refocusing time and a way for me to really get even more clear on what I wanted to do with it.
Well, I can keep asking some questions here, but I think instead I'm going to open it up for the audience. If that's all right, can I open up for the audience? All right, so, yeah, Jack.
Just following up the answer you just gave about passion and what you were talking about earlier in the information products, because you see a lot. And so I'm wondering kind of what, maybe some things you've seen that didn't work out, or what kind of goes through your mind when you're evaluating a person and their product and putting that together.
For the information products?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think people necessarily have to have, like, the passion thing's interesting, right? Because it's, I've met a lot of entrepreneurs that are like very pragmatic, very like ROI focused. They don't give a shit. They see a marketplace that they know has money and that they're reachable and they know, you know, this will work, and they just go in there and that's where they make their money. I don't know. For me, I have to be involved and have my heart involved in something to have it really exciting. Like, so for me, one of my favorite things is someone coming up to me and saying, "Hey, you've really changed my life because I was able to do," like the sleep coach person, right? Mm. Like working with her, like that's dramatically changed her life. So that's exciting for me. But when I'm evaluating marketplaces or ideas for things, like, so I'm always thinking about what's, like, if we can sell money at a discount, that's number one. That's an easier sell. So like for you, you're selling, you know, hey, here's how to save money on a big purchase or whatever. Like, so that's, you know, we can show the pragmatic benefits of that.
Right.
And creating a product, like my very first product was for cosmetic surgeons and dermatologists, how to get more cosmetic patients. And that was a pure ROI benefit for them. I mean, there's some emotional stuff involved too, but it was pretty pure pragmatic because managed care was eating their lunch, and this was 16, 17 years ago, so it hasn't dramatically changed too much. But that was, you know, that's one of the best ways that I evaluate something. And then I'm always looking at, okay, how do we go a different direction than other competitors? So I have this underground seminar I've been doing for 9 years where there's a bunch of other people selling internet marketing seminars, but I'm like, okay, well, we're not going to compete against them. I'd rather go a completely different direction. And so every year we bring in a new crop of people who are underground, who are really out there doing it and not selling how to make money on the internet is how they made their money. So that's, you know, so I look at that stuff. I look at, you know, can we provide kind of a fill in the blank silver platter kind of process for people, as we're, like, that was my first product, instant sales letters, which I call a fish product. You guys have all heard this saying, you hand the man a fish, you feed him for a day, you teach a man a fish, you feed him for life. Well, it's kind of bullshit. People want the fish handed to them. And the better you can get at that, the more your product is typically going to succeed. So those are a couple things that I think about.
Another question, yeah, Dana.
In bootstrapping your businesses in the early stage, when you know you're wanting to grow, what are some key things that you would use your cash to invest in to get the business where you want to go?
I would use, so if I was, you know, bootstrapping anything right now today, I would love to actually get pre-orders ahead of time. So there's stuff like Kickstarter, Indiegogo, which has been really interesting, where these marketplaces and platforms that you could get people to, it's not even an equity stake or anything like that. Like they, are you guys, how many are you familiar with Kickstarter, Indiegogo? All right, cool. So where I can, let's say it's, I don't know, let's say I'm gonna make these really sweet leather journals. So I don't wanna go buy 1,000 of these leather journals and store them in my warehouse tomorrow. I would much rather say, hey, I found this amazing Italian designer who can do this and this, and, you know, so we're gonna take pre-orders and it's gonna cost, I don't know, $25,000 for tooling, so that's what, how much I wanna raise. And so then it's gonna be like, you know, for $20 you get a journal, for $30 you get a customized one with your name, for $100 we get a journal party or something, like a launch party, and for $250 you're gonna get, you know, three journals and you get to hang out with the journal maker or something like that, whatever it is. But now I can see pretty quickly if there's life to it or not. Like, that's, I would much rather use my cash towards something that I'll be able to tell what the marketplace demand is as quick as possible. And so that's one of the platforms that's good for it. And if I look back, like that very first product selling to the cosmetic surgeons, we ran an ad in dermatologic surgery, which I know is on everyone's coffee table. And so I had 10 doctors who raised their hand. And over a course of 6 weeks, we sent out three sales letters to them. And finally, one guy sent back his order form, and that's for $900.
This is the last day, right?
The last day of the deadline, yeah. And I ran every single day up to the fax machine at my dad's office to go check if there's an order, and there wasn't. But last day of the 6 weeks, finally an order. And then I wrote back to the guy. I'm like, hey, you know, congratulations. Thanks for buying. It's being republished due to the popularity. You know, it's going to be available in 30 days. But we're not going to charge your card until then. So then that was like sort of my incentive to go create that thing. So I would rather like sell something in advance as a pre-publication offer, as something, so I can get some money, cash in the door, to figure out if there's a demand for it or not in some way.
Over here.
Kind of a lead off of that, Yanik. So my question's around, do you have like a criteria that you utilize to define whether or not someone's idea, product, service is leverageable enough? Like the one with the sleep thing, you know, did you look at some kind of success criteria, say, hey, we could teach other people this, or like, you know, Charles Martin, right? So he had grown $1 million dental practice, and then he went and taught other people to do it. And
right.
There's lots of people doing things like that. So is there a methodology?
One of the best criteria is, hey, can I sell money at a discount, right? So if I have success behind it that is a financial success, then I can more easily say, you know, invest $5,000 and this is going to turn into a $50,000 return for you, or a $250,000 return. If it's more of an emotional buy, so I have friends and people that I've worked with in the dating world, like how to pick up women, and you guys, maybe not, would be surprised at how big that that world is for selling information. And it's amazing. Like, I have guys selling $1,000, $2,000 programs, and even like immersion workshops where you go hang out with them and you go to bars together, and then they actually show you in the field like what works and what doesn't work. And it's like a couple thousand dollars. It's a big business. And so, you know, I've helped some of those guys. So now we're not selling an ROI, right? So now it's like the criteria is how big is the pain?
Mm-hmm.
And people won't buy prevention, but they will buy pain. And they're sitting around every Saturday night and they're staring at their Facebook page, and they're like, you know, everyone else is having more fun than I am, or whatever. Like, how big of a pain is it? So then that's the other criteria if we can't sell money at a discount. And then, you know, there's some other stuff to think about too.
All right. I'll work around to you, Richard, but Adam.
In crowdfunding, the Kickstarter Indiegogo approach, would you say that there's some resistance to it because there's not a principal protection method in place? These are not traditional investors. These are people that enrolled in the product, service, or cause. Not speculative types that just go, I can put up $10,000, you'll lose it.
It's a lot more smaller dollar amounts right now.
Right.
But you know, obviously with the Jobs Act, that could be interesting to see what happens. I mean, when I fund a lot of these, and I'm not looking for an equity stake, I'm looking for, hey, let's get somebody's business off the ground, but I also would, you know, I'm not gonna just fund all of them. I'm interested in what the product is or what the service is. So I think that there's, I don't know if there's some trepidation because you don't get an equity stake. I think it's been a great way of assessing marketplace demand and the people that have been using it. And you know, there's still a lot of work involved for it. It's not like my I'm friends with the CEO of Indiegogo, Slava Rubin, and he talks about these what's he call them, gnomes or gremlins. He's like, there's no gnomes that live on Indiegogo that are just looking to fund your project as soon as you put it up there. He's like, you gotta, you know, get some PR for it, you gotta spread the word for it, so you gotta do all the traditional marketing stuff, but this gives you a platform to have some, you don't have massive amounts of risk involved in it, because what's it cost you? You know, you put up a video and write some copy for it and go do the legwork for what it's gonna cost you to source this product.
Yeah. And in fact, we're doing a royalty model, which means there's nothing that they're getting premium-wise when they invest. It's sales of the futures, and still gets a good
royalty for the new book,
for whatever the venture may be, book, music.
This is the platform that you're building.
Right. This is we're working with several platforms. We're doing the principal protection part of it, basically warranting somebody's investment with a typical insurance model is premium paid up front. Then we invest that premium aggregated, so we've got an escrow that we can use to pay back.
Nice.
If the thing's
interesting idea.
Yeah, I want to talk to you about that,
please.
There was another question back there, and I'll come over here. There was a hand back there, yeah.
It's just more a comment of what the internet's done. For the internet, direct marketing companies all the time would send out these expensive mailers, and it was, you know, ships in 6 to 8 weeks. but ships in 6 to 8 weeks because they didn't have any. You know, if the response rate was high enough, they would then build it. And if the response rate was low enough, they'd send you, we ran out, or some other letter, and just walked away.
Yeah.
But for the internet, you don't have to spend all the money on postage and printing and all that.
Yeah, well, it's, so I'm not an attorney, nor do I play one on TV, but you know, there's definitely that, there's a 30-day rule, and then there's, the, you know, with the internet, like, so I have friends who mail like 100 million pieces of legitimate direct mail every year, and so they actually love it right now because a lot of people aren't in the mail anymore, and their responses are even going up higher. So if you guys are not using direct mail, it's something to possibly look at again because of you know, because of the lack of clutter in the mailbox and direct mail, like. I have another buddy who's just starting a brand new company. He just sold his other company for a lot of money, and he just put another piece out in the mail, and it's just testing right now. But they couldn't do the same things that they could do online. So there, you know, there's like pros and cons of each, right? Like, so he had a really nice package that goes out to these high-end kids in high school, like inviting them to this really high-end medical conference, like for future medical leaders. And it's like embossed with a great seal, and it's got, you know, Nobel Prize winners associated with it, and so you don't get that same tactile feel in the high end stuff that you couldn't get online. But I agree. I love the speed of the internet, right? Like we can test something literally tomorrow. I can buy Facebook ads or Google ads and find out a title of a book or find out whatever I want. And that to me is really interesting and exciting.
Richard.
Yeah, I'm a little confused about your analogy. I think that anybody can go out and sell, you know, money at a discount. I mean, if I offer you a dollar bill at 90 cents, you're gonna jump at it. I always thought it was the analogy would be to sell the dollar bill at a premium. So you're gonna get $1.10 for the dollar.
Maybe, so here's, When I'm saying sell money at a discount, so if we're selling information, which is, you know, my most of my world, so if I'm selling it for a couple thousand dollars, my margin on that is not, you know, it doesn't cost me that much to produce this thing. So let's say it's 3,000, it costs me 200 to produce it, or 300. So I'm selling it for significantly more, and that's where my premium is.
But that seems different than selling, you know, money at a discount.
You mean the sales pitch? The customer's buying it.
That's the pitch that I'm giving to the customer.
No, I understand that, but I mean, basically, you're not giving your services, you know, at a discount to where it's a complete loss to you.
I don't know if I follow you.
Or at that point, it's a lost leader. Because, you know, you expect to get that much more in return.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of loss leaders for most cases. I'd much rather charge premium prices and be able to deliver exceptional experiences and be able to. So I think we're saying the same thing, but in a slightly different way. Like I would rather, like so that product, I would, you know, it could cost me literally $200. I'm not going to sell it for $250 because that's what it cost me. I would rather. I price stuff based on what the value is to the end user.
Right.
And so if the end user, like I'm looking at how do I deliver 10 times to 100 times in value for that end user so that they're happy to pay me, you know, a tenth of that.
We've got not that much time left, but go ahead, Alan.
Yeah. Okay. I've got $100 trillion in Zimbabwe dollars I will sell you for $5, which is what it costs me. I don't want to talk about leverage, but seriously, two issues. One is how you create urgency in the situations. Number two, the different channels. You're talking about internet and email. What do you do with direct mail and other channels, you know, video, online, et cetera?
So I'll take the urgency one. That's an easier one. So we need to figure out in pretty much all the offers that we make, and if it's especially direct response, we need to have some sort of offer. We need to have some sort of deadline, and then I would also add, you know, some sort of reason why, typically. But the deadline is our scarcity element, and then that scarcity element has to be something that has a ring of authenticity to it, especially because it's so easy right now to be, you know, type in whatever and, you know, review or whatever and scam or whatever, and so you're gonna find out, you know, oh, these guys are making that, you know, it's really not a deadline that's legitimate, or it's really not a scarcity element. So now it's like a little bit harder. Like if I sold an ebook and I'm like, well, we only have 1,000 of these, Well, it's not quite true. but if I said, you know, we're not going to sell it after this date, and here's why, and because we don't want too many people finding out about this investing secret, and because it could actually affect the marketplace, and we're going to stop after, you know, 5,000 people bought it. So, you know, then there could be a legitimate thing, and then you really do stop it, then it actually creates more of an urgency next time you put out another offer. So you have to have elements of scarcity in there, and people will respond if there's if it rings true. And if it doesn't ring true, then they're just going to look at it and be like, yeah, that's BS. And then as far as the channels, that's probably a slightly bigger conversation. But I'm a big fan of using as many possible channels as we can. But it's too easy to see, like, there's, you know, 100 ways of getting traffic to your website online or whatever, and there's 100 ways of doing everything else. I would much rather get really good at a couple of them and then keep adding more channels or like kind of more pillars to what you're doing than go off there and just half-ass do 25 of them because, you know, you're like, wow, shit, everyone's on Pinterest. I need to be on Pinterest now or, mm-hmm. or whatever. And probably don't.
Okay, well, it's 1:30, so I'm going to have to wrap it up, right? So, but Yanik, this is awesome, man. I really appreciate your time. Thanks.